In the Song of Solomon, it tells us what the Lord looked like when he walked the earth. There's several. Could you please explain that to us? If you turn with me to Song of Solomon, chapter number 5, is where you need to go. And this is Song of Solomon is a conversation back and forth between Solomon and his bride. And you understand the Song of Solomon as a picture of Christ and the believing remnant in Israel and the seduction policy of the adversary to try to draw her away from him. And her, the key for her in waiting for her departed but soon returning groom is to keep her mind fixed on him. And we, if you remember the verse in Isaiah 26, is it, verse 3, the Lord will keep them in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Keep your mind on him, and you can endure all the things that you're going to endure. And while I realize most people teach the Song of Solomon a little differently than I just described it, it's really part of, it's the last one of the books of the wisdom literature, Job through Song of Solomon. And as you study Job, you see there is the believing remnant suffering in under the satanic captivity that Israel will be under, 42 chapters for the 42 months and the half of the trib. Then you have the book of Psalms, which are the mandates of the Davidic covenant, how the Davidic covenant is going to be put into place, the Psalms basically written by David. And then Proverbs is the wisdom that the believing remnant is going to need to have to resist Mr. Babylon the Great, the woman there, that's the harlot. When you get to Ecclesiastes, now you have Solomon, who once was a faithful guy. Now he's turned into a whirling. He's out seeking answers, not in God's word, but in the things of the world. And you see there the things that the believing remnant are going to have to resist. Then when you get to the end of Song of Solomon, Solomon literally is turned there's a place in 2 Chronicles chapter 9, verse 13, where Solomon transitions between being the true son, the son of David, into literally a picture of the Antichrist. And when you get to Song of Solomon, you're seeing Solomon seek to seduce the groom's bride and carry her away. And so there's this picture of the seduction that's going to be aimed at the nation Israel, the believing remnant of Israel in the tribulation, that believing remnant who goes and occupies the bride of New Jerusalem. And the key for her is going to be focusing on her Messiah. And there are two descriptions. Chapter 4, her groom describes her. And then in chapter 5, she describes him. Now, the description is the only physical description in your Bible that would be of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's not directly because this is Song of Solomon and Christ in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There's no real description of Christ in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But there's a typical description in Song of Solomon. And I say that, and what the question is about, they've heard me say that. They listen to, somebody told me this morning, said, I listen to 3 of your 10-year-old videos every day. And I go, oh, sheesh. That'd be, and he said, you don't talk as fast as you used to talk. Well, okay. A couple of years ago, I was in a Bible conference, and a lady came up to my wife. She says, I go to bed with your husband every night. I said, don't let that get out. And I didn't know who she was. And she said, I'm going listening to CDs and stuff, studying the Bible. And that's what these folks, the lady this told me that. And she said, but you don't talk as fast as you used to talk. So sometimes you hear me say things, you know, over a long period of time, and I don't mind that. But that's where these folks came up with a question. Song of Solomon, chapter 5, it starts in verse 10 and goes into the chapter. Notice what it said, verse 9. What is thy beloved more than any than another beloved? O thou fairest among women, what is thy beloved more than any other than another beloved, that thou dost so charge us? So they're challenging her. Who is your guy? That's what makes him so important to you? And so what you're going to read here is a description that she's giving and sort of prophetically of who she sees in the Messiah, who she sees in Christ. Verse number 10, my beloved is white and ruddy, the chiefest among 10,000. He's the Fairest among 10,000 to my soul, we sing in that song. You remember that? When it talks about he's the rose of Sharon, that comes out of Song of Solomon. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He's the most. He's the top. He's the best. When it says he's white and ruddy, if you look back at chapter 1, and you know, in this day and age, if you say somebody's white, you're almost saying that there's something wrong with them, the current political structure. And that's not the idea there. By the way, my skin, you know, people call me a white person. I'm not white. That's white. For me to be white, I'd have to be dead. Okay? But when you're Caucasian, your skin is more pink, pinkish brown. And when he says he's white and ruddy, the ruddy part is it's reddish brown. That's the color that Adam was. Adam was not a Caucasian. Adam was not a person with completely black skin. He's a person whose skin, he's made out of the dirt. And he's like reddish dirt. He was a person of color, not a person of absence of color or the presence of all color. And when he said he's white and ruddy, it's in if you look back at chapter 1, verse 5, the bride says, I am black, but comely, O daughters of Jerusalem, as the tents of Kedar and the curtains of Solomon. Look not upon me because I am black, because the sun hath looked upon me. What she's talking about, I've gotten sunburn, and my skin is colored. And so when it says she's white, it's in contrast to her color. But the issue of the coloring is the ruddy. So he's got the Lord Jesus Christ, and the reason I mention this, dwell on it, if you see pictures of the famous drawings of Christ, he looks like a reddish blonde with long reddish blonde hair, blue eyes. He looks like a strawberry blonde Irishman. He wasn't that. He wasn't the Italian rendition of what the painters do. That's all Catholic mythology. He was a Jew. He had a Jewish complexion. And so forth. So you need to understand that when it starts out that way, he's got this reddish brown complexion. Verse number 11, his head is as the most fine gold. His locks are bushy and black as a raven. His head, his head is like gold. He's got a bronze. I went to the restroom a while ago, put my tie on, and I noticed that I've got a sunburn across my top of my head. I didn't have that this morning. Which means I sat out in the parking lot out there and eating hamburgers and talking with people all afternoon, and you get some color. We had a bunch of people here this morning that just got back from Florida, and you can tell that they all glow because they've been in the sun. Well, that's the idea. He has this appearance, and it's not the standard appearance that you see. His locks are bushy and black as a raven. So he had black hair. And it's bushy. It wasn't long and stringy. One of the ways you know that is if you see sculptures or paintings of first century people, Romans. Have you ever seen you see those paintings and pictures, those kind of sculptures and busts are around. And they don't have long hair. The way people looked and dressed in the first century is not the way these effeminate-looking Jesuses in the pictures dress. One of the ways you know that is, for example, when Judas is going to betray him, Judas couldn't just say, he's the long-haired, straggly-looking guy in the crowd. He looked ordinary. He just looked like anybody else. So it wasn't his hair that stood him out, which is what, you know, trying to make him look like a ancient hippie, but his hair was black and it's bushy, and he had a full head of hair. His eyes is the eyes of doves by the rivers of water, washed with milk and fitly set. His eyes, have you ever seen a dove's eyes? Their color is gray, but when a dove looks, he looks at you like he's going to look right through you. They have this stare, this piercing stare. And they're washed with milk. They're clear, they're sparkling, and they're set, fitly set. In other words, his eyes weren't one looking one way or the other. His eyes were properly, fitly set in his head. He was his figure of looking at him was balanced. Verse number 13, his cheeks are as the bed of spices, as sweet flowers. His lips, like lilies, dropping sweet-smelling myrrh. You see the figures of speech that she's using. She's, when you get that kind of description, I don't know, guys, if your wife would describe you like that, or you're just an old shoe in the corner. But, his wife says that. Yeah, that's pretty much about Joe. But when you get that kind of a description, that's the thing about the Lord will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you. She's examining him. She's looking at him closely. She's captivated by him. She says his cheeks are as a bed of spices, as sweet flowers. My wife has planted a flower bed beside our house, and she's always been great with flower beds and making flowers. And it's just, neighbor came up and said, "That's just beautiful." And the next day I see him, he's over at his house with his wife out telling him how she did. I said, "Uh-oh, you got Mike in trouble over there." Well, she looks at him, and he says, "When I look at your cheeks, it's just like looking at a beautiful flower garden. His lips like lilies, dropping sweet-smelling myrrh." His lips are moist. They're not dried out and parched. His hands are as gold rings set with the beryl. That's a green color. When you wear a ring, I've got on a ring. When our 20th wedding anniversary, my wife gave me that ring, wedding ring. We already had, but she wanted me to have that one. And on our 50th anniversary, she bought me that one. So when I wear this, I wear that because I'm married. I wear this because I made 50 years, and it was a gift for my wife. And when you wear a ring, especially a gold ring, it's like a signet. It's a sign of love. It's a sign of ownership. You remember the prodigal son when he came home? The father, what did he do? He put the ring. "This is my son." See, he has that kind of bearing about him. His legs are as the pillar. His belly is as bright ivory overlaid with sapphires. Every time I read that, I think, he's got the original six-pack abs. Ivory, strong in strength in his core. His legs are as pillars of marble set upon sockets of fine gold. Marble is stronger than granite, and his legs can hold him up, and he can stand there on them without falling down, without giving way. Set upon sockets of fine gold, your ankles and your feet. His countenance is as Lebanon, excellent as the cedars. The idea there is cedars of Lebanon, they're strong, and they're straight. And the way he stands up, the way he looks at you, the way he appears, is someone with strength and character, and he's able to look straight on. His mouth is most sweet. Yea, he is altogether lovely. Now, when it says his mouth is most sweet, that's more talking about what's coming out of his mouth. And you know the verses about the word, that word was, I ate it and it was sweet. And all the verses about the Word of God being like honey and the sweetness of his words. And then he says, "This is my beloved, and this is my friend, O daughters of Judah." This is my beloved. This is one of whom I find all my delight. And he's my friend. He sticks with me. And he's not going to forsake me. And in this context, he might be gone, but he's coming back. And I just got eyes for him. He's the altogether lovely. Now, there's a passage that kind of calls all that into question. If you go to Isaiah 53, Isaiah chapter 53, "Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form or comeliness. And when we shall see him, there's no beauty that we shall desire him. when they looked at Christ in his humanity, the Word became flesh, he was not some supernatural standout. He was a normal human being. When Judas had to identify him, he had to go and kiss him. He had to single him out of a crowd and say, "This is him, and I'll give you the signal." And he didn't just say, "You'll see him when you see him, he'll have a halo walking around, he'll be, you know, some fairy-looking guy." He's a normal-looking person. There was nothing special, nothing particular, maybe I should say, about him. Well, Song of Solomon is not describing what men see in him. Song of Solomon didn't describe what people, just anybody. It's what the believer, what this woman who is, I mean, he's her altogether lovely. He's the one that her heart is fixed on. When she looks at him, well, she sees something different. So what you're reading in Song of Solomon is a description of his love, of the believer looking at him. He's my beloved, my friend. But you can see, and my point is pointed out, is you can see the difference in what he was like as opposed to what religion makes him out. So if you can jettison all the pictures in children's Bibles, and listen, these are pictures by the master painters of the world, but they're infected with a bunch of religious nonsense, and they paint their concepts of that. You see very few pictures of Christ. It's actually not necessary to see pictures of him, but if you do, it's very, very seldom you see any that are actually depicting him as a Jewish man. He worked for 2 decades in a carpenter shop. He didn't have hands that were made to handle, you know, lace panties, silk panties. He was a man. He worked. And he worked with his father, the carpenter. They called him one time the carpenter. And he knew what he was to have working hands and a working body. So the whole point of the question there is what did the Lord look like? And so forth, and that's really, for me, it's the passage that answers that. And they were asking about the passage I was referencing, so the answer there is Song of Solomon, chapter 5, okay? Second question is, do these names in the Bible have meaning? And the question they asked was Methuselah. Does Methuselah really mean when he dies, it shall come? And the answer there is yes, it does. It has several meanings, but that's its basic meaning if you take the Hebrew words and divide them up. And then the other one is, you look at Matthew chapter 2. Now, I'm not going to go back to Genesis 5 and go through the thing back there with Methuselah, because I think most of you've been over that time and again. But in the case of Methuselah, he's going to live 969 years, not because they told him how long he's going to live, but when you calculate it, the year he died was the year the flood came. And when he was born, it changed his daddy Enoch's whole life. So Enoch got a revelation. By faith, Enoch was translated. He got information from God about something that's going to come in the flood, and it had to do with Methuselah. So he named Methuselah. By the way, every name in Genesis 5 has a specific meaning. Probably the best way to get the meaning from me, my understanding, is use a good dictionary of proper names. In the back of a Scofield Reference Bible, we gave the teenagers this morning some Scofield Bibles. I recommend to you, we give all our teenagers, when they become teenagers, new good study Bibles with a good cover on them. We give them the Scofield Reference Bible, not the new Scofield. That is, the new Scofield is not Scofield. They changed all of his notes back in the 60s. It's not a King James Bible because they revised the Bible. But a Scofield Bible, that is the original Scofield, it's got a lot of notes in it that, you know, might not be so helpful, but it has some tools. One of the things it has in the back of it is a proper name index. And that proper name index will give you a good sound definition of each of the names. And it's fascinating to see those things. Now, the way you get that is you can get a Hebrew concordance and look the name up. The lexicon will generally give you the name. But sometime it'll be harder to understand and read and put together as the proper name index does. So I recommend that, you know, for me, that's always the first place I look to get the name of a name as it's parsed out in its meaning. The other one was Nazarene. If you come to Matthew chapter 2, verse number 23, and he came and dwelt in the city of Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophets, he should be called a Nazarene. Now, when it said that, be called a Nazarene, that's because he lived in the city of Nazareth. Now, the idea with the word, the name Nazarene, is it's said to mean the rejected one. And that's why he came to live in the city of Nazareth. So if you want to say Nazarene is the rejected one, I don't object to it. I don't think that's a real necessary meaning to it, but that's a general meaning that's given. You read that in the books. But the reason that he's called a Nazarene is not because he had the Nazarene vow. He didn't. It's because he lived in Nazareth and the town that he lived in. And he lived there because he'd been rejected, gone to Egypt, ran to Egypt, you remember that as a child, and when they come back, they settle in Nazareth. So his rejection association with that is where that comes from. Now they ask another question in that regard, and that is, and I'm going to say it like this, when you have names, you have to be careful how you define them and how you use them. Because they asked me about, should you call Jesus the king? Isn't that Israel's program? You have to be careful when you start taking the titles and the names of the Lord Jesus Christ and parceling them out and saying you can't use them in both programs. If you look with me at 1 Timothy chapter 1, it's unhelpful to make something a distinction that the Bible doesn't make it. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. Now, unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Paul says Jesus Christ is the King eternal. He's the rightful King of the universe. That's true in our program. It's true in Israel's program. Now, it was an issue in Israel's program before it was an issue in ours. You and I got added by God's grace, but he's still the rightful king of the universe. He's on exile. I'll give you an illustration. Take the name the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, the reference there would be to Jehovah. The Lord thy God is God of gods, but he's our God too, by God's grace. So when you say the Lord Jesus Christ, you're saying he's Lord, he's Jehovah. He's Jesus. That's his full title, Lord Jesus Christ. He's Jesus. Jesus, the J-E on that word is a contraction for Jehovah. Sus is the word for saves. The name Jesus means Jehovah saves or Jehovah Savior. Matthew 1:21 said, thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. If that's only applicable to Israel, what do you and I call him? Christ. The word Christ is the Greek word for the Old Testament word Messiah. Is he your Christ? Well, the word Christ means Messiah. It means the chosen, the anointed one. Well, if I'm going to say I can't use any of Israel's terms, that's Israel's language, then I can't call him the Lord Jesus Christ, because I say he's their Savior, their Messiah, their Jehovah. Well, then what do I call him? So my point is there's an old saying down south that I always appreciate. It said, that's a case of a pig picking up a piece of bologna and going too far with it. You can make distinctions where they don't need to be made, where they shouldn't be made, where they don't apply. So you have to be careful when you're using these definitions of words and names. Just don't make it more than it really is. Okay? So I just throw that out for you. Come with me to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. And verse 31. And this is a question, we get this question quite often. What about the unpardonable sin? You know, we may have even talked about that in the past. Matthew 12, 31. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. And whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven unto him. But whoso speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. Now hold your hand there and come over to Mark chapter 3, because it's said just a bit different in Mark 3. Mark chapter 3. Verse 29. Mark 3, verse 28. Verily I say unto you, all sins shall be forgiven unto the sons of men, and blasphemies wherewith whoso they shall blaspheme. But he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost hath neither forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation, because they said, he, that is Christ, hath an unclean spirit. So when they attributed to Christ, in this context the Pharisees did, they said, you cast out devils by the spirit of Beelzebub. They associate Christ working with the power of Satan. And he said, when you do that, you're blaspheming not just me, but you're blaspheming the Holy Spirit. So there's a sense in which the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit was when they attributed to Christ the work of the Spirit. And he said, that won't be forgiven you. Now the difficulty with making that, what that passage is talking about, is you're making, who's more important, Christ or the Holy Spirit? You can sin against Christ and you can be forgiven, but you can't sin against the Holy Spirit. So if blaspheming the Holy Spirit is what took place when they spoke, they attributed to Satan the work of the Spirit in Christ, then you're saying it's more important not to blaspheme the Holy Spirit than it is Christ. You're making him more important than the Holy Spirit. And that doesn't make sense. It makes a lot more sense to say it's a sequential thing. You blaspheme Christ now, you blaspheme the Holy Spirit later, that's going to be more consequential than this. Because If you blaspheme the Father, rejected him, then you blaspheme the Son and you reject him, and then you blaspheme the Holy Spirit, there's nowhere to go out after that. If you've worn out the Father, you've worn out the Son, you've worn out the Holy Spirit, there's no other members of the Godhead to seek forgiveness from. So it's better to understand it, to my thinking, sequentially than to say, it was just when the Spirit, when they attributed to Satan the working of the Spirit in Christ. They say, well, then what's that talking about? In essence, what Christ is saying in Mark 3 is that if you blaspheme me and you attribute to what I'm doing, when you get over there in the book of Acts, when the Holy Spirit comes, because he hadn't come yet on them, when you get over there and you blaspheme, then there's trouble. Then you've lost opportunity. So if you go back to Matthew 12, where he kind of lays it out, in Mark, you know, we've been studying Mark, and I've said to you over and over, Mark, is he condenses stuff. He doesn't leave any extra words involved. So Mark's is much shorter and is much more pointed to Christ as the servant. We're getting after what he's doing. But when you go back to Matthew, he's going to elongate this out and put some more explanatory details. If you go back to verse number Matthew 12:22. Then was brought unto him one possessed with the devil, blind and dumb, and he healed him, insomuch that the blind and dumb both spake and saw. And all the people were amazed and said, Is not this the son of David? But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, This fellow, by the way, see that phrase, this fellow? Sometime you ought to just read through the Gospels and see how often they looked at Christ and said, this fellow. They had an absolute revulsion. You know, in the last year, or the last presidential cycle, the news media got a what do they call it, Trump derangement syndrome. Even, I listened to people this past week on the radio, and they just mentioned Trump's name, and people just go angry. And one commentator said, nobody associated with them can have any worth. I got no use for them. I'll just spit on them, throw them out. Well, that's Trump derangement. Just hear the guy's name. That's what they did with this. This fella is a pestilence. And that you watch that phrase, it's fascinating how often that phrase, so much of your Bible enters into your language. And when you hear people say, this fella, that's who it is. They have this disdain for him. This fella doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of devils. Jesus knew therefore knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself cannot stand. If by Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against him. So shall his kingdom. Shall then his kingdom stand? Verse 28. If I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come to you. That's the conflict between God's kingdom and Satan's kingdom. But what they're doing is they're saying, you cast out that evil spirit by the power of Satan's what's working in you. So the people he's talking to here are unsaved Jews. That's the point. Nobody who is saved is threatened with the unpardonable sin. It was lost Jews that he was telling, you follow that road and there's no hope for you. Not in this world or the world to come, the kingdom. So it starts out, he's talking to, you always ask yourself who's being spoken to. He's talking to unsaved Jews. You know that because who did Christ minister to? Well, the Gentiles, minister to Israel. Who was he? Matthew 15:8, he was a minister of the circumcision. So he wasn't preaching to Gentiles. He was preaching to Jews, and he was preaching to unsaved Jews about the danger they were in crucifying him and not having an opportunity to repent. And I say again, obviously, this is a sequential thing, because he's not saying you can kill me, but you speak against the Holy Spirit. He's more important than me, and you won't be forgiven. Is a time thing. If you look over at John chapter 1, John chapter 1, verse number 6. If you go back to 1 Samuel chapter 8, when Israel said, we want a king like all the Gentiles, and they chose Saul, God says to Samuel, God the Father, they haven't rejected you, they rejected me. So as far back as that point in Israel's history, they were rejecting the Father. But that came to a head in John chapter 1, verse number 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. That's John the Baptist, and he was sent directly to Israel by God the Father after 400 years of God not talking to him. Look down at verse 30. John is talking about the Lord Jesus. This is he of whom I said, after me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me, and I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. And John bare record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not, but watch, he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizes with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. John says, the one that sent me said to me. John had a direct revelation from the Father to go to Israel and prepare the way for his Messiah, for his Son. And he got, that again is the first time in almost 400 years that God had spoken directly to anyone. So John has a message to the nation of Israel from the Father. They didn't receive it. In fact, Herod had a birthday party, and Herod wound up cutting John's head off, and Israel didn't peep a word. So Israel has the testimony from John the Baptist, but they don't receive it. A believing remnant does, but the nation as a whole. And you remember we talking this morning about the nation Israel being a commonwealth. The nation Israel was a commonwealth nation. That means they hold all this the property of the nation in common, and the decision of the leaders of the nation affects the direction of the whole nation. And the leaders, they say nay. Now, when the Lord Jesus Christ comes, what do they do? Well, that's what Matthew 12 is about. They're rejecting him. Three times in Matthew 12, he points out their rejection. He says that there's a great parallel. 12:3, I say unto you that in this place is one greater than the temple. Chapter 12, verse 41, the men of Nazareth shall rise in Nineveh, I'm sorry, shall rise in judgment with this generation and shall condemn it, because they repented not at the preaching of Jonas, and a greater than Jonas is here. One that's greater than the temple, greater than the priesthood. One that's a greater prophet. In verse 42, at the end of it, behold, a greater than Solomon, a greater king. The greater priest, the greater prophet, the greater king is here, and you've rejected him. And that's why the old-time dispensationalists put the fall of Israel in Matthew 12. Because what Matthew 12 is showing them is that you've rejected him, and you don't want him, prophet, priest, and king. In the midst of that, Christ says, you know, you can speak all these words against me, but if you blaspheme against the Holy Spirit, the deal's done. There's no forgiveness in this world or the world to come. So when they rejected Christ, they still had one more member of the Godhead. That's when Christ prayed, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Peter in Acts chapter 3 picks that up. In Acts chapter 3, verse 12, and when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Acts 3:12. Or why look ye earnestly on us as though by our own power or holiness we have made this man to walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his Son Jesus, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But ye denied the Holy One and the Just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you, and kill the Prince of Life, whom God raised up from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. And his name, through faith in his name, hath made this man whole, whom ye see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him hath made this given him perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I wot that, notice, through ignorance you did it. What? You say, they knew what they were doing. We've been studying Mark 15 on Wednesday night. He saved others. They saw his credentials. He claimed to be the king of Israel. They heard his claims. They just didn't believe him. And so they denied him. And Christ says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. There was a blindness of unbelief that had captured them. And Christ pled that loophole of ignorance. And he says, through ignorance you did it, as did your rulers. but those things which God has shown by the mouth of all his prophets, that Christ should suffer, he has so fulfilled. Repent you therefore and be converted. In other words, you've got an opportunity of repentance because God pulled the extension of mercy loophole. And when the Holy Spirit came, Acts chapter 2, verse 4, when the Holy Spirit came, they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And they heard what he said. They understood what the message was. If you look at chapter 2, verse 28, Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promises unto you and your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. With many other words, did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Get out of that apostate nation and separate yourself and join the little flock who's going to go into the kingdom. So they understood what was going on. And the Holy Spirit testified and bore witness to them of all those things. So when you start out the book of Acts, this last member of the Godhead comes with this renewed opportunity of repentance. If you don't accept that, there's nobody else no other opportunity. But they had that opportunity. When you come to chapter 6, you'll see it happen. Chapter 6, verse number 5, and saying please the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. Just like Peter was filled with the Holy Spirit in Acts 2, just like the assembly is filled with the Holy Spirit in Acts 4, and they speak as the Spirit gives them utterance, Stephen is filled with the Holy Spirit. Well, he stands up in chapter 7 and addresses the Senate and Council of Israel. He's filled, speaking as the Spirit gave, God the Holy Spirit speaking through him. So when he comes down at chapter 7, verse 51, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do ye. He was laying the indictment from the third member of the Godhead on them, and you're sinning against the Holy Spirit now. You're rejecting him. And there's nowhere else to go. There's no other place of refuge for you. Chapter 8, verse 1, and Saul was consenting unto his death. Now, someone asked me, in Acts 7, it doesn't say that they blasphemed the Holy Spirit. They spoke against him, but it doesn't. The word blasphemy means to speak evil against someone. And the text doesn't say they blasphemed him. But hold your hand here and come with me to 1 Timothy chapter 1. Because if you need the term blasphemy for what's taking place in Acts 7 in particular, Saul was there consenting unto the death of Stephen. And when Saul was there consenting unto the death of Stephen, he tells you that there was at least one blasphemer there. 1 Timothy 1, verse number 12. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who hath enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who was before a what? A blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious. What was he doing in Acts 8? He's consenting to the death of Stephen. And after he did that, verse 3 says, as for Saul, he wreaked havoc of the church. So Saul went about, he didn't just join his nation in blaspheming the Holy Spirit. He took up the cause of destroying the testimony of the apostles. So in Saul's case, just take him, since he blasphemed, there was no salvation in this world or the world to come. Now, what's that? Look at Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 5. Hebrews 2, verse 3, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? God also bearing them witness with signs and wonders and with divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost. So this message began to be spoken by the Lord here, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, is confirmed unto us, Hebrews says, by them that heard him, God bearing them witness with the gifts and divers miracles of the testimony of the Holy Spirit. Verse 5. For unto the angels hath he not put in subjection the world to come, whereof we speak. So when the prophetic program speaks of this world and the world to come, they're talking about the kingdom, tribulation of the kingdom. So there's no hope for that blaspheming nation in that hope, that kingdom in time, the world in time past, or the world to come. So literally, God had to interject a new world in order to save Saul. Go back with me to 1 Timothy chapter number 1. And get 1 Timothy 1 in one hand and Colossians chapter 1. 1 Timothy 1 and Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, verse 25. Whereof I made a minister, Colossians 1, 25, according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which has been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest. So the ages and generations, the worlds back here didn't know that information, but now it's been revealed. They knew about the kingdom. They didn't know about this. They knew if you blasphemed here, you wouldn't have forgiveness over there. So Paul said, God put a new program in here. Interjected it, 1 Timothy chapter 1, which allowed blaspheming Saul to get saved. We read verse 12 and 13, verse number 14, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ with exceeding abundant with faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. For it is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Howbeit, in order for me to be the chief of sinners, the leader of sinners, for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all longsuffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting. So Paul is the first person that gets the longsuffering in a line of people after him who are going to believe unto eternal life and have God's justification and everlasting life. You can't get everlasting life unless you've been justified. God's righteousness will give eternal life to anybody that has perfect righteousness. You never have that except in Christ. When you have it, then he can give you everlasting life. So Paul's the pattern. For what? For right there. That's why that had to be placed in there. So the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit is something in the Bible that has to do with what the nation Israel rejecting the third member of the Godhead, having no opportunity for salvation, looking to that kingdom. They lost it. That's when that fall of Israel takes place. And there's no hope for them. Paul comes along and says, God concluded them all in unbelief, that he might have mercy on them all. I say that just to remind you that the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit is a dispensational issue and has nothing to do with the dispensation of grace. Our pattern is there in 1 Timothy, where Paul, the blasphemer, is a pattern of long-suffering of God's grace. So don't worry and don't threaten people with the unpardonable sin. There is no unpardonable sin today. And you don't have to worry about it. We had young people at camp last week, a week before last now, and I was... One of the fathers that was here this morning was sharing with me an email he got from one of the leaders at camp. And he said, and you have a youth camp like they have there, and you get kids from all over, lost kids, church kids, our kids, and so forth. And he said it was fascinating that they had some discussions among the kids about getting saved. And he said it was always the Shorewood kids that just come up and go, you know, here's the gospel, believe it. And he said they had some discussion about whether you could lose your salvation. And he wrote to his father, he said, it was your kid that spoke right up and gave three verses to show you couldn't lose your salvation. And he wrote to us just to say, thank you for training your kids. I told him, I said, if you go through Barbara Wilkie's class, you got a bachelor's degree in Bible, you know, before you're in the ninth grade, because she really, our Sunday school does a great job with the kids. But, you know, that's what you have to do. You have to have it grounded in what God's Word says and not something else. You don't need to be afraid of losing your salvation. You don't need to be afraid of unpardonable sin. That's what you get when you mix the programs together. So, I hope that helps, okay? I hope you guys are watching, too. If you have other questions, well, ask your husband at home. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace, and just for the opportunity to look in your Word, see some clarity, and give our lives stability because of it, in Christ's name. Amen. All right, praise the Lord.